Praise the Lord and welcome to the Voice of Bethel broadcast with your friend and brother, Pastor and Dr. John Boyd. So glad to have this opportunity to come into your homes, your cars, your jobs, wherever this broadcast is finding you on this Wednesday morning. My friend, this is the day the Lord has made. What are we going to do with it? We're going to rejoice and be glad in it. God is such a faithful God. And because he's so faithful, we constantly owe him praise and gratitude. David said, if he had 1,000 tongues, he said that would not be efficient enough of giving him all the praise that he's worthy of. When you think about it, he was the one that woke you up this morning, closed in your right mind. I mean, you could think clearly. You didn't have dementia. Couldn't forget what your name was. You had the activity of your limbs. You could get up, you could walk, lift your hands up, wash up your own self. And sometimes we take all those things for granted until we are faced with a situation that we no longer have the capacity or the ability to do it. But while you have it, how many know you need to give God a praise because he's such a faithful God to you and to me both. And so we take this moment to just say, Lord, we bless you. Lord, we thank you. God, we give you all that you're worthy of. For that's why I love that scripture. It says, from the rising of the sun to the going down of that same sun, his name is to be what? His name is to be praised. So how many of you come today to give God a praise, to think of another day? Many times we don't even realize how much God has watched over us and kept us in spite of our own selves. If it hadn't been mercy on our side, many of us would not be here today. You know, I was there talking with a young lady, Sister Stacy, who goes to our church on Sunday just before the service started. And she was saying to me, she had a young lady, she does hair. And she was in her 30s. And had just came in, got her hair done, very attractive young lady. And here she was in a situation where it looked like her whole life was in front of her, her whole life. And she walked out a day or two later, died. She died because she had a blood clot. You know, she had a blockage. And she said, Pastor, this thing, she had one and died. You had two and lived. And, you know, that's why, you know, you can never be thankful enough. You can never give God enough praise and honor for what he does. Sister Ann, I see you. Sister Solange, I see you. Yes, Jesus. God is, all I know about him is that he's faithful. That's what I know about God. God, I serve a faithful God. How many of y'all serve a faithful God? No matter what the situation is, we come to realize he is just faithful, faithful, faithful. And for his faithfulness, we love him. And that's why I want to build your faith today. I want to build your faith in God. Because without faith, it is an impossibility to please God. You can't please God without faith. Eva, should I say? You cannot please God without faith. And faith comes by hearing. And hearing what? And hearing the word of God. So I want the word of God to be activated in your life. Somebody say, activated. I want the word of God to be activated in my life. Some of us, we really miss out because we haven't allowed the word of God to really be activated in our lives to the place where everything that God has for us in store for us, that we are faithful to follow through on that relationship with God. You know, it's consistency. It's all about consistency. The problem with the body of Christ many times is that we're so inconsistent in our relationship with God. Today we're praying, today we love God, tomorrow we're doing something else. That's why Paul said, when I desire to do good, what? I'm facing evil. Evil's ever in front of me. It's before me. And so when we realize the battle, look at somebody and say, I'm in a battle. How many of you realize that you are in a battle? Oh, come on, somebody say that, Pastor. I know I'm in a battle. And I'm not in a battle sometimes. I'm in a battle all the time. That's what Paul realized. This is an ongoing, consistent battle. And the enemy is determined to make sure you lose the battle. But tell somebody, I'm not losing this battle. Look at yourself in the mirror. We're not losing this battle. We are not losing this battle. That's why you got to make up your mind. I come to fight. I come to fight the good fight of faith. And I'm going to fight to the bitter end. How many made it make up your mind? I'm going to fight to the bitter end. I don't know what my end might be, but you know what? I'm going to fight till the end. Because what I realize is that God is, he's faithful. That's the thing I know about our God, that he is so faithful. He is so faithful. He is so faithful. Yes, he is. Somebody say he's faithful. Pastor, I know he's faithful. I know that he is a faithful God. Sister Ann Solange, Tome, Rolanda. Okay, I always like to welcome all of you that are online. So I know who I'm teaching to today. Okay. And so we share this word of God. I want to go back to 1 Corinthians 15. 1 Corinthians 15, 51, 53. I don't see Sister Debbie on yet, or Sister Dina. They might be at work. 1 Corinthians 15, 51 and 53. This is what it says. It says, take notice. Take notice. That means you need to pay attention. Somebody say, pay attention. Many times we come to church, we're in church, but our minds are somewhere else and we're not paying attention. Many times God has a word for us. We don't know the word because we're not paying attention. Some of us are on our cell phones, texting folks. And I'm not talking about scriptures, I'm talking about something else. Some of us are playing games on our cell phones. Some of us, our minds are wandering. And you got to bring your mind in. Somebody said, bring my mind in. So this scripture opens up and says, take notice, pay attention. Why do I want you to pay attention? Because I'm going to tell you a mystery. Everybody say, a mystery. How many of you like a good mystery? I don't know about you. I love a good mystery. How many of y'all say, Pastor, I love a good mystery? Growing up, I used to love to read Sherlock Holmes books, detective stories. How many of y'all love a good mystery? Christine's there. Pastor, I love a good mystery. Now, I want to do something. Let me pause right there. I need two announcements that I do not want to forget these. First, Brother Kareem McFarlane, Mother McFarlane, who has been a member of our church for many years, she transitioned on yesterday, and her funeral services will be here at New Greater Bethel on Friday, April 26th. Friday, April 26th, Pastor Wooten, Mother McFarland's funeral services, homegoing services will be here at Greater Bethel. Tentatively, the wait will be from 9 to 10. And then 10 o'clock will be the services. She's been a faithful member of New Greater Bethel, her and her family. So we want you to come out, missionaries, everybody come out and be very supportive of the McFarland family. And then also, and so with great condolences I offer to the family and knowing that your mother was a faithful lover of God, which is the most important thing. More than anything else, she loved her God. And then on this coming Saturday, the 13th, our own sister, Merlene Antoine, I always get in trouble for saying it wrong, but her brother transitioned, Ernest Antoine, and so his service is on this coming Saturday. It's at the Carib Funeral Home, Caribe Funeral Home. That's 1922 Utica Avenue in Brooklyn, New York. 1922 Utica Avenue in Brooklyn, New York. The viewing will be from 8 a.m. to 9 a.m. and the service from 9 a.m. to approximately 11 a.m. And then the burial will be at the Woodbridge Memorial Gardens, which is in Woodbridge, New Jersey. And the repast will be announced. So we want to go there and be supportive of Sister Merlene. She is over our seniors ministry. She is another person who's been extremely faithful for years in this ministry. And these are the times that we need to be there for them to show up that they have people that will stay with them in these very emotional, crucial hours. So again, that's Brother Ernest Antoine, which is on this coming Saturday there in Brooklyn, New York. And again, the wake is at 8 o'clock in the morning. So please be mindful. We ask you to be there, show up, and let's show these families that we love them and we're going to stand with them through this critical hour. Now, let me go back to the text now. I know sometimes when I get to teaching, and I go, oh my God, I didn't do it. So I wanted to do it while it was very much on my mind. So it said, 1 Corinthians 15 and 51 says, take notice, I tell you a mystery. And I ask you, how many of y'all like a good mystery? Okay. So I said, I love a good mystery. Okay. It says, a secret truth, an event decreed by a hidden purpose or counsel of God. So there's a purpose. There's something in there that we need to learn. And he said, I'm going to tell you the mystery. You know, I'm going to explain it to you. He says, we shall not all sleep in death. We won't all die. But we shall all be changed or transformed. Well, this transformation, how long does it take? In a moment, in the twinkling of an eye. You could even bat your eye quick enough for what is about to happen. At the sound of the last trumpet call, for a trumpet will sound, and the dead in Christ, that's my mother, my father, all those that go to Mother Walker, all those that went on before us, will be raised imperishable, incorruptible, free and immune from any decay, and will be changed, transformed from that mortal body to immortality. For this perishable part of us must put on the imperishable nature, and this mortal part of us, this nature of that is capable of dying, must put on immortality from death. So that is what keeps us encouraged. That I'm going to study this word. I'm going to love on God, because this life, as I said, the young lady there was, how old was she? Was 35 years old. Sister Merlene's brother was 45 years old. We don't know where death meets. I was listening to the news of that mother who was suffering with mental illness. She had two twin girls, and she suffocated them. We don't know where death meets us. But I'm not worried about tomorrow. I just worry about who holds tomorrow. And I know that our Lord Savior Jesus Christ has developed a path of life that leads from this life to eternal life. See, saints don't really die. What we do is we go to sleep. We just rest in him until that morning when the trump sounds. And how many say, Pastor, I'm going to be ready. How many of you may gotta be my pastor? I'm not going to church. I'm not jumping and shouting. I'm not paying tithes and offering. So I'm not ready. I'm going to be ready. And that's what our walk with church is. Our love for God is not about this life. This life is short. I mean, if you live 100 years, that's short. You can't compare that to eternity. And so God wants you ready for eternity. How many say, Pastor, I'm going to be ready for eternity. I'm going to be ready for eternity. All that I do, my focus is aimed at something better. Now, it doesn't mean I have to wait to live a good life in eternity. I can live a good life now. Why? Because I have a relationship with the Lord Jesus Christ. He came that I might have life and that I might have it how? In abundance. God wants us to operate in the abundant life. But that only comes through the Word of God. When we have this relationship with Him and a relationship with the Word, that's what it says. He came, the Word came that you might have life and that you might have that life in abundance. Why? Because the life of the Word teaches you how to live life. Isn't that something? The life of the Word, in the Word, through the Word, teaches you how to live life. Many of us are destroyed for our lack of knowledge of God's Word. Now, we know so many other things, but we don't know His Word. And that's the job of the enemy. The job of the enemy is to make sure you stay ignorant. In some cases, we stay dumb. Because some of us, we know the Word, and we still are not obedient to the Word of God. And so when you're not obedient to the Word of God, then you unlock the door for the enemy to come in and cause all kind of dreadful things in your life. And you don't want to give the enemy access to anything of that sort. You want to be able to stand in a place and say, Lord, I thank you because you're faithful and you're good. And I made up my mind, I'm doing those things that will cause my life to live so I can be everything that you desire for me to be in my destiny. I need to fulfill God's divine destiny in my life. It's like being at the right place at the right time. A lot of times we think it's like happenstance. It's not. You're at the right place because God desires to use your life. Now you must be like Abraham as he stood in front of Isaac with a knife in his hand about to slay his son. And he says to God, here I am. Here I am. There's no hold back. Whatever you want me to do, I'm going to do it. I'm totally given over to you. And that's where that word in Hebrew, hineni, comes from. It means, Lord, the fight is over in me. Wherever you want me to go, whatever you want me to do, I'm totally submitted. As Jesus was, we just got finished Resurrection Sunday and Easter, Good Friday, where he says, Father, if it be thy will, let this cup pass from me. But not my will, let your will be done. Or we're studying David in the book, The Tale of Three Kings. And David, part of David was, I'm sure, wanted to kill Saul. But it was his obedience to the Word of God, who says, I will not kill God's anointed. I'm not the one to make that decision. God has to. Which means that if you're going to do that, you have to really trust God. When someone's after to kill you, and not by themselves, they got armies, they got dogs, they got everybody, and then you have the opportunity to avenge it yourself. And for all apparent reasons, in the natural, would seem only right. Well, you know, he's about to kill me, Pastor. I need to kill him first. But David said, no, God chose him as king. And if he wants me to be the king, then he's going to make sure he makes the way for me to take the throne. Until then, I will not touch who God has placed there. It takes a lot of faith to do that. Takes a lot of faith when everybody around you is telling you, kill him, kill him, kill him. And you're going, I won't do it. I won't do it. I won't do it. Why? I won't do it because I trust God. And God proved himself. Not once, but twice in David's life. He did it with Saul and he did it with his own son, Absalom, which we're about to get in this next session. Now tonight, don't forget, Dr. Morgan will be teaching the word tonight as he's going to continue on the message. He started Sunday morning, which is so powerful. So next Wednesday night, we'll be back into the book, A Tale of Three Kings. And again, you don't want to miss it as we enter part two and we finish up part one. So you don't want to miss all that God is doing here. Now, that's why you have to have an active prayer life. Put that in the chat box, active prayer life. Joanne, I need an active prayer life. Because what God responds to is prayer. He said the effectual, fervent prayer of the righteous does what? Avails much. It'll save a life. It'll make death back off. And that's why we can't wait. And prayer works with faith. So you can pray, but if you don't have the faith to believe, then it's just a bunch of words. And that faith must be a part of who you are. It must be part of the integrity of your heart. So I need to study the word to build faith. So when I pray, I believe so that God can do what I believe. If I say it with my mouth and not my heart, then it doesn't happen. And so what happens? That's why the church is what? Frustrated, angry, mad, because they're not getting the result, but they haven't put in the time nor the work to develop the kind of relationship with God so God can do the work. The Bible says you can't waver like the wave that is driven by the wind. One minute he's doing it, the next minute he's not. One minute, you vacillate back and forth. You got to be a concrete person, focused and knowing what God is willing to do. And then when we pray, we don't pray, and this is important, we don't pray our will. And that's even in death. You know, sometimes we want people to live forever, and maybe that's just not the will of the Father. So you have to say, Lord, let your will be done. As Jesus said, you know, while you would have thought, this is Jesus. I mean, he's only 33 years old. If he did what he did in 3.5 years, what could he do if he was here for 40 or 50 years? And he said, let this cup pass from me. But the will of the Father was that he would die. He said, it pleased the Lord to bruise him. So this was all in the plan, the script of God. And so you've got to begin to seek God for the script of your life. What's my purpose, God? What plan do you have for my life? I'm not here by accident. I have a purpose. And every day when you pray, you want to say, Lord, allow me to be in the purpose that you've set for my life. Lord, you've got to pray this. Lord, not my will, but your will be done. I've got to pray the word. See, a lot of people have frustration too because we don't pray the word. We pray our emotions. We pray our feelings. We pray our desires and our wants and not his. Because anytime you pray the word has to answer. Why? Because he said, the word that goeth out of my mouth will not return void or empty. It will accomplish what I sent it to do, what I pleased it to do. So if I'm praying the word, then the word has to always work. It's when I get outside of the word. Outside of the word, then it doesn't work. Tell your neighbor, say, pray the word. Pray the word. And sometimes praying the word means, as Jesus, I got to go to Calvary. Jesus said, take up your cross and follow me. How often? Daily. So there's an ongoing process in all of us that there's a cross where we must die to our flesh. You hear me say this all the time. You got to die to your emotions. You know, people kill folks because they're in their emotions and their feelings. You make your worst decisions when you get in your flesh or your emotion or your feelings. That's why my father is always saying, son, sometimes you need not to have the conversation until the cool of the day when temperatures get down and you can think clearly. Most of all, when you can hear God talking to you. Not you, not your friend, not your bestie, but you can hear God talking to you. So David, who was a man after God's heart, because he prayed and he sought the purpose, the plan, and the will of God, even when it was very, very unpopular. Psalms 4:1 says, hear me when I call. This is David's prayer. Lord, hear me when, how many of you, that's your testimony. Lord, hear me when I call. I don't want to call in vain. I want to make a whole lot of noise, be a tinkling brass and some cymbals going off like a drummer. If I pray softly, quietly, I just need you to hear me. God's not deaf. I don't have to shout at him, scream at him. He hears the sincerity of my heart. How many know it's all about heart? H-E-A-R-T, heart. He's the only one that judges us by our heart. People judge by what we have on, our outer attirement. What is your attire that you have on? Does that look holy? Does that look right? So he judges us by what we wear, what we have on. That's how man does. God judges you by your heart. Hear me when I call, O God of my righteousness, which means I'm in right standing with God. Our lives must be about being in right standing with God. That I'm living a righteous life. And I tell people all the time, you got to be in the fight. My dad used to say, how you doing, Pastor Boyd? He said, you one thing, I'm fighting the good fight of faith. This is a fight. That's why Paul said, put on what? The whole armor. See, you put on half the armor, wherever the armor is not at, that's where the enemy's coming at. He's always coming at your weakness. Hear me when I call, O God of my righteousness. Thou hast enlarged me when I was in distress. When I was in distress, you came to get me out, God. When I was going through, you were there. How many of that came to you? That's your testimony. How many of you remember when you were in distress and God delivered you? When God got you out? How many of you can put a note of praise in the chat box today and say, God, I thank you. That's why I say, I can't forget what the Lord has done for me. Can't forget how he set me free. Can't forget how he brought me out. No, never I can forget. Thou hast enlarged me when I was in distress. Have mercy upon me and hear my prayer. Tell you that word mercy, God. How many times that mercy pleaded your case? How many times when God should have killed us, but he gave us a second chance and a third chance and a fourth and a fifth and a sixth chance? Psalms 5:3. I hope you're writing these down. Psalms 5:3 says what? It says, my voice shall thou hear in the morning. Something about rising early. Even Jesus got up early to pray to his Father. Sometimes it's not just what a person says, it's what they do. Sometimes you learn more by observation than by conversation. Sometimes watch a person's life. Watch their commitment. Watch what they're sold out to do. That's so often I tell some of the young armor bearers now, I say, you know, you could have never hung out with my dad. You don't have enough drive, enough passion. I remember him being 70 years old, running up a flight of stairs here in this building. And we'd be on two steps. He'd be at the top and say, what are you going to do when you get my age? He was driven. Tent time came. He was driven. You know, everybody else, here's a man 70 years old going into, even to his late 70s and getting ready to go to the 80s. But he was always driven by the fact someone is dying and on their way to hell. And my job is to throw out a lifeline. Throughout a lifeline that will save them from death, from damnation. Satan, you know that he comes to steal, kill, and ultimately to destroy. Our job is to stand in the gap, to intercede for a dying man, a dying woman, no matter what state we find them in. Because you got to realize one day we were all dying and on our way to hell. No matter how morally good we were, if we did not have Jesus Christ in our life, and we had not accepted him as our Lord and Savior, we will still die and go to hell. Go to hell, go to hell. Psalm 69 says, the Lord has heard my supplication. Now that's why you shout and jump. That's why you dance, and because you believe in faith. Watch this. Even when I don't see it, and that's the thing about faith. Now you got to remember this. Faith is not what I see. Can y'all please put that in the chat box? That's something that we've got to get across. I'm waiting. Would you put that in the chat box? Let's go to Hebrews 11 and 1 for a second. So we're trying to tie prayer and faith together. Remember, is that how, even Jesus says, he says, you know, the Pharisees and Sadducees, they stand in the middle of the street, the square, they're yelling, they're screaming, and he said, because they want attention. God doesn't want attention, he wants your heart. That's the attention he wants. Lord, I love you. How do you love him? With all my heart, soul, mind, and strength. So Hebrews 11 says, this is the NIV, now faith is confidence. So you got to have, you got to know for yourself. And that's why the enemy wants to trap you at a place where you begin to worry and doubt. But then you hold God back. You stop him from giving you the miracle that you're worthy of. What makes you unworthy is that you don't believe God will do it. Now, faith is confidence in what we hope. You got that? Faith is confidence in what we hope, not what we see. What we hope. That's why hopeless people commit suicide. For an assurance about what we do not see. Let me say that again. Now, faith is confidence in what we hope for an assurance about what we do not see. I do not see it, but my divine hope that is already done. That was to give you the ability to call those things that be not as though they were. That's why you get up in the morning. You got to declare, I'm blessed. This is a blessed day. I'm going to rejoice. I'm going to be glad in it. God, you're going to use me today. This is the victorious day, even if I got tests and trials. And what's the sense of having victory if the victory is not being tested? Victory means that I've been in a war and I won. How many believe you're already the winner? Somebody shout, I'm already the winner. I'm already, Sister Priscilla, I'm already, yeah, it's not what I see. Now, the devil's going to challenge, and the enemy is going to challenge you. He's going to constantly tell you, see, it ain't going to happen for you. Look at this. You better give up, throw in the towel. You've already lost the battle. And you got to be able to stand and say, in spite of what I don't see, I know the God that I serve. And I know this, all things are possible if I can just believe his word. He's the same yesterday, today, and forevermore. He's a healer, a deliverer, a peace giver, one who instills joy in us. All these are what we own. They belong to the children of God if we walk in that place. It says, by faith we understand that the universe, the entire universe was formed. He said, how do we understand this? By faith. So God already realized when we look into the celestial skies and we see stars and moons and maybe shooting stars and all the incredible things, we saw the eclipse, that there's something much bigger than all of us. And though we can't put our finger in it, our faith says it's our God. By faith, we understand that the universe was formed at God's command. He spoke it. Go back to Genesis and it was done. So that what is seen was not made out of what was visible. You get this? So there was nothing there. He spoke a word, bam. Some people call it the great explosion. God wants to have a great explosion in your life today. God wants you to speak the word and watch the unbelievable take place. And it is there because you have the confidence to believe that what is seen was not made out of what was visible. There was nothing there, but I spoke it into existence. And God still gives us that power to speak things into existence. It says, by faith, Abel brought God a better offering than Cain did. So when God asked Cain and Abel to bring him a sacrifice, and this is so important today, our tithes, our offering, our giving. Cain said, I'm going to hold back because, well, I don't trust God. I don't have enough faith that if I give God my best, he'll turn around and give me his best. Some of you have messed up on that end. You know, you haven't given God your best financially, your time, You want God to give you more time in life. You want to live a long life, a healthy life, a prosperous life. But yet you're pulling back on God. You're going like, yeah, give me God. But I don't really trust you. It doesn't work that way. You've got to come to a place to trust God through it all, knowing that he is faithful to his word. That's why you got to know his word. He is not a man that he should, that he could, that he wants to lie. It's not in his nature. He can't do it. He cannot do it. And so when I read this word, I can stand on the word. His word is the rock that is higher than I. And I can live in that place. How many know you can live there? You can live in that place where the Lord wants you to be at. It's God's desire that you be everything, Sister Joanne, that he wants you to be, Sister Ann. By faith, Abel brought God a better offering than Cain did. By faith, he was commended as righteous when God spoke well of his offering. And by faith, Abel still speaks even though he is dead. I mean, when you do the right thing, your life is a legacy you leave behind. Your life of righteousness, your life of dedication, your life of faithfulness to God. That's what God wants, my God. I'll read this, the fifth verse. Says, by faith, Enoch was taken from this life. By faith. How many of you are ready to take a walk and just walk away with God so that he did not experience death? Wow. By faith, which means he believed that. He believed that he could get so close to God. Oh, my God, that gives me chills. That you could have such communication with God that one day you just walk down Jamaica Avenue, Linden Boulevard, Springfield Boulevard, whatever street you want to walk down, and just keep on walking till you walk right into glory because of the intimacy that I have with my God. And you know what he says? And Jesus says this. He says, learn of me. I want you to know me. How many of you believe that? How many of you believe that God really wants you to know? And here's the thing. He is so deep. He is so wide. He has so much depth. It would probably take an eternity just to get to know him. But every day he avails himself to us. Oh, this is giving me chills. Just see that every day he's sitting there waiting on us. He's inviting us in to his presence. He's inviting us to come to learn. He said, learn of me. And learning takes time. So where do you place your time at? We learn a lot of things in life, and that's good to learn. But nothing more important to learn than to learn your Savior and your Lord, to learn him, and I learn him through the word. He says, come learn of me. My yoke is what? Easy. My burden is light. We go through unnecessary yokes and burdens because we don't know him. We don't know the word. So we don't rightly divide the word. We don't really take this word and apply it as he desires us to apply it. That's why sometimes when I hear people talk, I'm in conversation. I say, how you doing? I'm sick. I said, you what? I said, Pastor, I'm sick. I said, you what? They say, I'm sick. I said, you what? Finally, they get it. Why are you taking on sickness? The Bible says, by his stripes, we were healed. So I must say, I walk in divine health. Doesn't mean that the enemy is not going to attack me. No, he's going to attack. But the Bible says, no weapon, no matter what the weapon is formed against you, has the ability to prosper if I have the faith to believe. But I have to have the faith to believe that by his stripes, we were healed. That he sent his word. That's what he said. I sent my word to heal you. But again, if you don't believe the word, then it doesn't happen for you. That's why faith is so critical. How many of you believe he's really coming back? How many of you believe there's a rapture? How many believe that you're going to be changed in a moment, in a twinkling of an eye? Do you believe that, or does it just sounds good to hear people say it? He could not be found because God had taken him away. For before he was taken, he was commended as one who pleased God. This is Enoch. The benefit of pleasing God. When a man's ways please God, he makes his enemies to be at peace with them. Verse 6, and I stop here. And without faith, here we go. And without trust and without faith, it is impossible. It is an impossibility to please God. So don't tell me you want to please God. Your shouting doesn't mean you please God. You lay on the floor doesn't mean you please God. Your faith means you please God. I trust you. Now the Bible says the trying of your faith. So that means that your faith is going to be tested. Everybody put in the chat box, tested faith. Everybody's faith is going to be tested. Can't go from the kindergarten to the first grade or first grade to the second grade without being tested. Tested faith, said Priscilla. Tested. Your faith must be tested. When the trying or the testing of your faith worketh patience. Patience in the process. Patience to work. Watch God work in you. And when you want God to do something in you, how many know you got to wait in the process? Now, I took a lot of time teaching on the root and the seed. And I was telling you, I took my little granddaughter to watch. I was a Karate Panda, one of those little animation movies. And his mentor said he was holding a pit, a seed. And he said, the greatness of the tree is inside of this pit. God made you with greatness in you. Now you must fulfill that greatness through your walk and your obedience and that process that God has you in. But the job of the enemy is to bring you to a place of disobedience when you go against the working of God. What Israel could have been, do you understand something? Adam and Eve, and then probably us, could have been living in the Garden of Eden now. Eating the best fruit, no crime, no war, no murder, laying down with the lions and the tigers and the bears. How wonderful that could have been, but they were disobedient. Israel could have went right in the promised land. Grapes so big they had to have two men carry them on a stick. Pomegranates. Two people to eat them. But they were disobedient. Every time you're disobedient to the will of God in your life, you mess up stuff. I tell people all the time, why you be messing up stuff? God want to bless you and you just mess it up. And it's something about human beings. We know we get right to the door, and I hate to put it this way, and screw it up. That's why you got to stay in a place of consecration and communication with God. So God can say, no, don't go down that way. No, don't do that. And what? We listen. I tell my granddaughters all the time, you got to listen. Gigi, you got to listen. Blake, you got to listen. Go to Rikers Island, thousands of young men over there. You know why? Because they didn't listen. That's a task so simple. Is that a simple task? Just listen. Listen and then obey. But many of us are so stubborn and bullheaded. No matter what God tells us, we're determined because we think this is, that life is Burger King. I'm going to have it my way. Sorry. The Bible said there is a way that seemeth right unto a man, but that way leads to death. I don't want to die. Why die when you can live? Why be sick when you can be well? Why be poor when you can be rich? If I just listen to the voice of God, that's what God desires. And without faith, it is impossible to please God because anyone who comes to him must believe. You got that? Don't tell me you're coming to Jesus and you don't have no faith, you don't have no belief. To him must believe that he exists, that God, the Lord Jesus, is here, that he rewards those who earnestly or diligently do what? Seek him. Tell your neighbor, you need a seek. When nobody else is seeking him, you need a seek. You need early in the morning, you get up, you need a seek. Late at night when you go to bed, you need a seek. in the middle of the day, you need to seek something in you that's constantly seeking out the purpose, the plan, the will of God. Seeking out that intimacy like Enoch had, that I want to walk with God. I want to walk off the earth. I don't want to die. I just want to be raptured. I think that was different than being raptured. That's just walking away with God. I see it, sister, and seek. For before he was taken, he was committed as one who pleased. Listen, he pleased God. Put in the chat, Lord, help me to please you. That is my desire, to please you, God. Well, my friends, listen, we want to provoke our prayer life. We want to provoke those things that God is calling us to. Psalm 69 said, the Lord has heard my supplication, the Lord will receive my prayer. But you got to say that in faith. That's when the faith comes in. Great scriptures, but do I believe what I'm saying? Psalm 17 and 1. David said, hear the right, not the wrong. Hear the right, O Lord, attend unto my cry. Give ear unto my prayer. He's saying, God, will you listen to my prayer that goeth not out of foreign lips? These aren't strange lips. God, you know my voice. You know who I am. Please answer my prayer that I'm praying. But as for me, Psalms 35 and 13. But as for me, when they were sick, my clothing was sackcloth. I humbled my soul with fasting, and my prayer returned into my own bosom. Times all you can do is get on your face. But you got to have faith to believe that when I'm down here, God is moving. God's doing what he promised he would do. Came to heal, deliver, to set free. Is that what you want? I don't know, I want that. Hi, Debbie, there you go. Psalms 42 and 8, I love this. Yet the Lord will command. Somebody put it that he will command. He will command his loving kindness in the daytime. How many know it's the daytime right now? It's 108. How many know God has commanded loving kindness in this hour? And in the night his song shall be with me, and my prayer unto God, the God of my life. Oh, the blessing that goes with me, flows with me. I don't deny it. I believe it with all my heart, soul, mind, and strength. Last one for this session. Psalms 55 and 1. Give ear to my prayer, O God. Hide not thyself from my supplication. That's what we want God to do. We want God to hear us. We want God to answer. What does God want from us? Consistency. He wants us to pray his word, to seek him first with all our heart, soul, mind, and strength. That's why he wrote in 2 Chronicles 7:14, if my people, which are called by my name, will humble themselves and do what? And pray. Seek my face. Don't seek my hand. Don't say, what can I get from you now, God? Seek my voice and turn from their ungodly, wicked ways. He said, I'll forgive their sin. I'll heal their land. We thank you today. I want you today, this faith, Kevin, to give an opportunity to give. All this is about giving, giving of yourself. When you give, you're blessed. The Bible says it is more blessed to give than to receive. Because when I give, I got to get back. God is not mocked. Whatever man sows, he reaps. Every time I do something good, no matter, I may be expecting it from the person I do the good to, but I don't have to do that. God, whoever I do good to, God will bring it back to me some way, somehow. So today I want to, as many of you who sow a $50 seed, you that are online, Pastor, I want to sow if you're sowing. Or as close to what you can do, just put sewing. I know you're sowing a seed today. Everyone that is going to sow, say, Pastor, I was blessed today. I want to sow a seed. I believe God, he's about to bless my finances. I stand on his word that he's faithful to it. And he does it in ways you can never imagine. So give, cash out, sell. You know the various ways that you can give. Give and watch how God's going to bless you for your giving. Yes, God, we thank you. We thank you, Lord, for the word that builds faith in us. That we can be those men and women that will go out and conquer this world for God. Because we have the faith to believe it. Hallelujah. Thank all of you today that were here. All you that sowed today. All of you that built your faith today. We realize that here at Greater Bethel, we are changing the world. That's why I tell people, you go with God and God's going to go with you. Here at Greater Bethel, we'll change the world. How? One mind, one heart at a time. God bless you. See you tonight, 7 o'clock for service with Dr. Caswell Morgan. Then join us on Friday night for service. God bless. See you next time.